What's up, Metal Injection Junkies? Frank here with the one and only Mr. Kerry King. Kerry, thank you so much for taking some time out of your day for this, man. I know that you've been...
What else am I going to do?
I don't know. Party? Drink?
This time of day? No.
Hang out?
I had some drinks last night.
Right. Well,
today, not so much.
All right.
Not yet.
Nurse that hangover?
It'll be fine.
But From Hell I Arise is out and ruling the world right now. I imagine that it's just like kind of a load off because there was a lot of build up and everything to get it out there. You know, how's the feeling for you and the band overall right now?
When the announcement finally came, I was so stoked for the band because everybody knew I was in the band.
Right.
You know, but nobody knew Phil, Mark, or Kyle. And those guys had to keep their mouth shut, as well as me about them and Paul about them. So when it finally hit who was in the band, I was so happy because they can finally talk about it.
Right.
And they kept their mouth shut, you know. They kept the secret, you know. They kept the mystique, which is very old school. You know, we live in a I-need-to-know-now society.
Totally.
And I think surprises are cool. So that's why we did it.
It was just amazing to see it all unfold, you know.
I respect those guys for keeping their mouth shut.
Right. Yeah, it's kind of an amazing thing. But, you know, when I first heard through the grapevine that you were doing this thing and you know, going solo, my first thought actually was just like thinking about like the mental side of it. You know, it's just like, what is it like for Kerry King to go from this one of the largest bands in the world, you know, going from Slayer to doing his own thing? You know, is there a difference in the work ethic and the process and the psyche behind it all?
The process, no. You know, it's business as usual for me, for sure. You know, I still put riffs on my fucking iPhone. I play out of an amp about the size of my boot, you know, nothing extravagant.
Yeah.
Could I? Yeah, I could, but, you know, if it's not broke, don't fix it. That's how I've always been. And, you know, the weirdest thing was coming from a band of stature to essentially starting over is an awakening. You know, I know my name carries a little bit of weight, but some of the places we played, I'd walk in and tell the guys, welcome to starting over. Because
right.
We're essentially starting over. You know, we had some great places, some great billing on some great festivals. We had some cool one-off headliners in Europe, and it was overall quite a success, but there is a bit of starting over to an extent. That's more than I thought it would be. And, you know, I haven't started a band in 40 years, just an odd thing to say, but, you know, and I still don't know how to do it.
Right.
It's a learning curve.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny because I've heard you say that term before, starting over. I was just like, it to me at least, it feels more like you always were Kerry, you are Kerry, and it's an extension of what you did, you know?
Yeah, for
like
sure.
The groundwork that you did. So
for sure. And you know, some of the, actually all the spots we got on these festivals, we got without anybody, any of the booking promoters hearing a note. They didn't know who was in my band. It was just my name, and that was super humbling, super humbling. I was very stoked about that.
Doing Kerry King, the band, is it as liberating as I think it is?
I guess. You know, the last Slayer record, I wrote 95% of it anyway. You know, it's kind of the same situation. That's why when we get to this point, you know, when people still gripe about, hey, it sounds like Slayer, I'm like, what the fuck did you think it was going to sound like?
Right.
You know, come on. It's what I do. Did I branch out a little bit? A little bit.
Yeah.
You know, I probably put more punk on this record than I would have the next Slayer record had there been one. But, you know, that's where I come from, and I wanted people to get a taste of everything that made me who I am. Because this is my project. I don't think of it as a solo project. This is my band. I expect all these guys to be here till we're all done, I hope. You know, and I think me being solo got legs more than it should have. Because I am solo, but this is my band, and I want everybody to know. Yeah, it's called my name. I never wanted it to be called my name. That's just how it happened.
Right.
And here we are.
I wanted to clear that up because I've read about that, but for anybody who at home who hasn't heard, like, why did it become Kerry King the band?
Every time I landed on a fucking title that I liked, Once you got to the trademark attorney, he said, you don't want it.
Right.
You know, and that's the final word. When a trademark attorney says that, fucking run away.
Right.
So we ran away. And it came time for the U.S. festivals that we were going to play. They were going to announce, and we needed a name. So we went with my name.
And that's funny. I mean, like, was Kerry King taken on Facebook and shit like that? And you had to retrieve
it? Not that I know of.
No?
Not that I know of. I mean, some of the names we came up with, you know, I probably could have bought them out. But, you know, if there's going to be any confusing factor in the future, you don't want that.
Yeah, totally.
You know, so we just dropped it and moved forward. You know, is there an instance where it might become Kerry King's something, like Ritchie Blackmore's Rainbow? Maybe.
Right.
You know, I'm not against that. But, you know, if this goes, you know, if this has a long road to record two, it's probably going to stay.
You have had, like you mentioned before, I guess a 40-year career. Like, that's like, astounding. I mean, if you think about it, very little people will have the life and experiences that you've had, you know? It's like you are one of one in 7.8 billion people out there, you know? That said, in the 40-year career run that you've had, is there anything that you've learned about yourself along the way?
Pretty good at drinking. Pretty good at that. Pretty good at guitar. You know, those two kind of go hand in hand.
Right.
You know, the thing that I learned early on, like around Hell Awaits, record two, because I got fame thrust upon me very early. Mm-hmm. My first record came out when I was 19. Hell Awaits came out when I was 20. Fucking Raining Blood came out when I was 22.
Wow.
But around Hell Awaits, you know, I found myself reacting like a famous person, you know, how you think a famous person should act. And I caught myself doing it, and I'm like, why did I just do that? I don't want to be like that. I don't understand why anybody isn't nice to the people that support them. And at that point in my career, it was for 2 years, not 40 years.
Yeah.
And I caught myself doing it, and I said, I'm never going to do that again, you know? So what I learned about myself is be cool to the fans who support you, because without them, you're nothing, you know? And there's no reason to think you're above them. You know, it's just, I was young and I had to figure shit out.
You mentioned that drinking and guitar playing go hand in hand. Is that like your muse? Do you usually drink and then play? Like,
No. There was a time in my career where I might have a shot or a drink before a gig. And then I rethought that too. I'm like, you know, these people paying money to see me play deserve my best. So why am I altering my best? Right. So I stopped that immediately. I remember an Ozfest, probably 2004-ish. I think that's the last one we did. But I'm sure Black Label Society was on it, because Zach's always with Ozzy. And sometimes I would go and vent on Zach Wilde's bus and say, dude, we're doing a shot. I'm just in a shitty fucking mood. Let's go do a shot.
Right.
So I'd run on his bus in my stage clothes. And we would, you know, have a shot, and I'd go out. I mean, that's not going to affect me playing, but, you know, I still stopped that. But, you know, friends like Zach Wilde, you know, sometimes you break the rules and have fun with your boy, you know?
No, of course, you need that. And especially, I'm sure nowadays, after the show, you party, you know, and get down.
If there's going to be a party, it's after the show, for sure.
Right. I mean, you are responsible for so many amazing riffs out there, memorable riffs within metal history. Do you have a favorite of your own?
No. I wouldn't even know where to start, you know? Hopefully it's on the next record.
That's a good answer. Leave him, you know, wanting. I would put it this way. If you were a Hollywood film director, you or a casting agent, you did the best job.
I didn't do bad.
You know, like it's a great lineup or a cast of dudes.
It's like when I picked Gary Holt to fill in for Jeff.
Right.
Yeah, perfect. Best choice in the world.
Perfect.
Best choice in the world. He was fucking perfect.
Yeah. So was there anything in particular? I mean, of course, I love all the guys in the band. And so I know what they bring to the table. But is there anything that, any specific reason that, you know, when you were thinking about this, about putting this together, like, okay, I choose, this guy for a very specific reason?
Well, funny part of the story is Gary was part of my plan from moment one. But in hindsight, it's like, I can't take all the pieces of Slayer. know, because then more than it is now, people will call it Slayer 2.0, Slayer Light, you know,
right.
Had I had Gary Holt, you know, I knew I was already taking Paul regardless. He and I work very well together and have for decades.
Right.
That's why I kept him. But any more pieces, and it just would have been, it would have been a blur as to what band's what, you know, and that's why I didn't do Terry Date on this one, because it would have been another piece of Slayer. And Josh Wilbur, who did the record, did an amazing job. Wonderful, wonderful new guy to collaborate with. And I plan on doing record two with him if my time is free when his time's free. That's the plan.
I did want to talk about your relationship with Paul, because as you mentioned, you've lasted decades together and through many drummers and iterations and things that have happened. I mean, it's always come back to Paul. What's the you know, the magic there? What's the secret behind keeping a relationship like that going?
I'm number one, first and foremost, a very loyal person, be it to my bandmates, be it to my people I endorse, from guitars to amps to whatever. I won't leave unless you give me a reason to leave. And Paul, you know, he never would have been away from me had he not quit twice. You know, that's a conversation for him.
Right. Okay, fair. Totally fair. You know, and another thing is, of course, on this record, you have had your hands in everything. You know, you're involved in lyrics, riffs, recording, probably even drum charts, I think I read.
Yep.
You know, everything. Being the guy at the center of everything and the director, did you find any one particular piece harder than the others?
Recording's always hard, just because of the precise precision of the moment, you know. Sure. I don't like recording. I never have. But it's the means to get people product so you can go play for them. You know, I just like to play, you know. Is everything I play precise live? Fuck no. No one is.
Yeah.
You know, it's pretty close.
Yeah.
To the point where people are going to enjoy, you know, the live environment. But the meticulous preciseness of recording has bothered me since I was 19. It just sucks. But, you know, it's a means to get out and do what you really enjoy doing. And for me, that's playing. This time, the only ones that played together were me and Paul, and Mark came in and did demos with us. So Phil and Kyle never played with us. Phil came in and did solos. I did all the rhythms. Kyle came in and played bass, and I would watch him as he played, because I know playing this speed, this tempo, you know, you can miss a note and it's not your fault.
Yeah.
It's just, you heard it incorrectly.
Right.
So I would just watch him, make sure he's playing things right. Cause even if he's playing it and I'm listening, not watching, I might not catch it. You know, some of the stuff so fast, you know, and then 2 weeks later you hear this note and go, motherfucker. But I watched him, cause he never played with us. And if he needed correcting, I'd say, hey dude, you messed that part up. It's like this. So we'd get it right.
You play, I mean, is it a situation where you play click tracks in a studio to get it right, but do you play click tracks live?
No.
No.
No, and not even the studio. We might start a click track and like 30 seconds in, take it away. Just let the song go where it goes.
Okay, just to get the feel and let it ride.
You want to start here so you don't, by the end, you're not racing through it.
Is that the way you've always recorded? Like, or
off and on, yeah. You know, especially something that's got a groove. Because if you're playing something fast, it's just going to be fast. Comes to a point where it's not going to get any faster, you know. Because if it does, you may not be able to give the riff its actual value. The riff kind of suffers if you go too fast.
Right.
And I've had to pull Paul back many times because, you know, it gets so comfortable, you just go faster.
Yeah. Yeah. It's one of those things where even as a Slayer fan, like when Divine Intervention came out, I was just like, oh, did they start using clicks like for this record? It just was so precise, you know.
Well, Paul, I mean, Dave's a loose cannon, you know, and that's not a jab at Dave. He's just a loose cannon. He goes off the rails, he comes back on the rails, he's all over the place. Yeah. And he's a natural. He's really good at what he does. To where Paul is really good at what he does because he practices to be that good.
Right.
Dave's just got it. You know, he's a fucking natural. Paul works very hard to be as good as he is, and I think that's the main difference between those dudes. But I think Paul is more solid and will not be all over the map speed-wise. He'll speed up, but he's not going to go like this, you know?
Right, yeah. Well, yeah, Paul's a beast, man. And I don't want to dive too far into Slayer. That's not why we're here. But of course, you know.
I'm leaving.
But of course, you've been in the news a lot lately because of, you know, the conversations going on. And in one of them, you mentioned how it kind of was a surprise to you, the upcoming shows and everything. And I just wanted to see what was that conversation or contact like, was, you know, to be a surprise? Like, was it mostly manager driven or?
I turned those down for the longest time. You know, you can imagine we've been turning down offers since December 1st, 2019.
Right.
You know, and at that point, you know, I thought, no, we're never going to play again. You know, Tom retired, so it's written.
Right.
And the offers keep coming, The money goes up. And this one came around. It was one we were booking shows for my band. And I'd go to my manager. I'm like, are we talking about my band or Slayer? What are we talking about here? He's like, Slayer. And I'm like, yeah, but that's done. You know, it's, we hung that shit up. I dropped the chains, done. But then it started getting to where this is really going to be the 5-year anniversary of our last tour. And I went, that's kind of cool. 3 shows, 5-year anniversary. Okay. You know, yeah. That's about all I thought about it. And the funny thing about this story is I didn't tell anybody in my band. I've never been in that situation, you know, right. And that the news dropped that we're doing 3 shows and everybody blows me up. I'm like, God damn it.
Right.
So it never occurred to me to tell you guys. Never fucking occurred. It wasn't a secret. You know, they can keep secrets. I know that. And I felt so bad. Now I'm like, it never occurred to me. You know, Paul knew, of course, but poor Phil and Kyle and Mark, you know, they all texted me and blew me up. I'm like, I'm so sorry, man. It never occurred to me, you know, this is what's up. This is what's going to happen. If it happens again, it's going to be the same thing. We're never going to fucking make a record. We're never going to fucking tour. This is my band.
Right.
So it was a clarity moment.
Yeah. So it's not like a Motley Crue thing.
No.
Yeah. Okay.
No. And we never signed a contract saying we were never going to play again.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I think you're doing it fair, and but I also just wanted to clear that because there is a lot of talk about, Slayer's back and doing things or whatever else, but it is.
Yeah, they
all
retired.
About,
here they are.
Yeah,
doing shows again. I'm like, it's hard not to, you know. And I'm trying to be real and definitely say, hey, we're not going to tour again, and we're certainly not going to record again because I have a means of doing that now with my band. So,
yeah. So that's
the only 3 shows for now. Mm-hmm. And I say for now because I know Europe's going to come knocking. Hey, man, you guys played America. Come see us.
Right.
You know, so it wouldn't surprise me if something like that happened. But it's certainly not on the books right now.
Right. Right. So it's all about Kerry King, the bands.
Yep.
And like, so what's next you have in store for Kerry King?
Well, we got the Lemagon Macedon tour, which I leave Thursday. I leave in 2 days.
Gonna be sick.
Yeah, in 40 minutes we get to play on that. And that's, you know, it's hard because people want to see me play Slayer songs, and I'm going to. Like I've always said, for now, I play stuff that either I wrote or co-wrote, so there's no more fucking nonsense on the internet. There's already enough nonsense. So on this, we're only playing a couple songs, you know, and the rest, you know, I had a hard time picking from the Kerry King songs because... You know, there's 3 that I want to play, and I don't have time to play them. So
right.
After that, in November, we have 2 Mexico shows. And then in December, we got like a week and a half in Australia. And I think early next year, we headline U.S. and then ideally headline Europe.
So lots of touring.
Oh, for sure.
Do you feel
that's
that?
Why, that's why record two, you know, there's things to talk about it, but, you know, it's a ways off just for touring.
Right. I know it's probably too early to tell, or maybe not even in your head, but, like, is pushing Kerry King the band to the status of Slayer, is that, like, the aim or the goal or what you're looking for?
You know, in a perfect world, sure. I don't expect it. You know, if it happens, good for us. And there is no Slayer, so maybe my band can fill that void. You know, and we have lots of material for record 2. And I think as soon as the touring cycle for record 1 wraps up, Paul and I are going right back in the studio and, you know, using the tour chops to get it done quick. And this one, the recording was done in 2 weeks, which is pretty unheard of.
That is really quick.
Yeah.
But it took longer to write, I'm assuming.
Oh, we worked on it. I mean, I started working on it 3 months after the last Slayer show.
Right.
Plus, I had stuff from Repentless left over. And I still have stuff left over for record two from Repentless, from Hell I Rise, from stuff I've written since From Hell I Rise. So tons of stuff.
So, I mean, that said, From Hell I Rise, would you compare it, if you had to compare it to, like, any of your Slayer work, is there, like, a, you know, somewhere in the lineage you would compare it?
Not really, but I'm super fond of it. I think From Hell I Rise is super complete, be it heavy, be it punk, be it thrash. It definitely knocks on all those doors and totally. comes blasting through.
totally. Yeah, I mean, it's, like, it's no... surprised that you're a punk guy, you know, Undisputed Attitude, everything like you've done kind of shows that off, you know what I mean? Was punk as big as metal to you?
No, and I rebelled against punk. Jeff brought it in early on, like when he shaved his head and we're all like, what the fuck are you doing? he brought it in and no one liked it. But, you know, Jeff got into it and, you know, he force fed it to us. Until the point where I finally went, you know what? You don't have to be Ronnie James Dio or Rob Halford to be a badass singer. You know, you just gotta believe in what you're presenting and present it with force, with anger, with angst. And once I got over that, I'm like, oh, I get it. It's just angry music with musicians that probably aren't as good. You know, sorry, punk guys.
Hey, man, they can learn a new chord. It's okay.
Hey, man, I can play a power chord like a motherfucker.
So we do know you as, like, I mean, the world knows you as, you know, one of the most metal dudes out there. I would love to know what's the non-metal stuff you listen to.
You know, I don't, if it was up to me, I wouldn't put something on like that. But my wife's DJ at our house, generally. So, you know, 70s rock, you know, and that could be heavy shit like fucking Sabbath or Deep Purple, but it could also be Elton John, you know.
Yeah.
You know, and I like 60s stuff, you know. I like, you know, if it's a good song, I like it, you know. There's very few good songs I don't like, but, you know, I never, ever need to hear Sweet Child of Mine again.
Yeah.
I can live a happy life without ever hearing that song again.
Yeah.
Great fucking song, not a billion times in,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah. No, I feel
it. Pick another. That's a great record.
I feel that about some metal songs. You know, if I never had to hear Walk again. Like,
yeah, I don't need to hear it. That's another one. I do not ever need to hear Walk. I'm so sorry, Philip.
Yeah.
I'll never need to hear that song again.
it's so ubiquitous at some point. You're like, okay, not again. You know, Nirvana's shit. Like, there's plenty of artists like that.
Plenty.
You know? From Hell I Rise is out. You guys are kicking ass. I love it. Please go check it out if you haven't yet. They're going to be on tour nonstop. And of course, as Kerry mentioned, they're going to be working on new material as soon as they're done. Just sounds like a vicious cycle.